All right, welcome to the Helen Zell Writers Series. Just a friendly reminder to please silence your phones so we don't have any interruptions. One of our Zell MFA students, Elinam Agbo, is going to be introducing our speaker. We have two more.
Wow, I can see you. When I first encountered the heroes of Wayétu Moore's debut novel, She Would Be King, I felt a strong urge to shake the nearest person and say, look, here are the black superheroes I'd always wanted to read, and the ones I didn't know I even needed. But these words, in spite of their good intention, didn't feel quite right. What of Charlotte, the slave who dies and then gives birth to a son impervious to the weapons of those who killed her? And somehow equating Besad, June Day, and Norman to the cozy and neatly drawn blockbuster names that have monopolized the word superhero didn't feel quite right either. I could almost hear my ancestors shouting their rage, telling me to stop making bad comparisons and return to the story in front of me. That's just it. I could almost hear the voice of ancestors. Reading Wayétu Moore's novel is a kind of reawakening. I was taken to a place not unlike home, a place I knew but could not name, where I met an old woman who told me to sit down by the fire and listen. In this way of summoning both legend and memory, Moore reimagines the founding of present-day Liberia, a nation formed by former slaves and indigenous peoples. The novel is narrated by an eye who is Charlotte, but now timeless and ubiquitous as the wind, a voice that crosses an ocean to comfort the immortal Besa when she is alone and in pain, when the solace of death, promised to the rest of the living, evades her again and again. Any writer who dips into the pool of the supernatural and what we call the surreal knows to expect questions like, what are the rules of this world? Why did you choose to tell the story like this with the magical? And while these questions can open new doors, they also come from the assumption that there is a known familiar world, i.e. the Western one, to which the foreign is secondary. In other words, these visible walls around us make up our real world, even though the mere existence of the marginalized body is evidence of perpetual resistance to the fiction of the norm. So why not let language and art too convey such resistance? In an interview with Salon, Wayétu Moore explains, this form of storytelling has always existed. It's just that it was suppressed before because it was seen as unchristian or uncivilized. And now that it's being published in the West, it's being presented as an introduction. Indeed, She Would Be King evokes a world at once ancient and modern, where the spiritual realm is inseparable from the physical. Here, words breathe life into a woman who is cast out of her home and a slave who, even upon learning that she has died, pushes a life into being. Like the people of Liberia, Moore's three heroes come from different parts of the diaspora and find one another between words, worlds, and language. Together, they arrive and strive toward one goal, to keep fighting and to keep surviving. Between them, Besa, June Day, and Norman have immortality, unbreakable skin, and the ability to vanish at will. But they are not reluctant heroes called upon to save their people. They are their people. Fighting for them is not a choice. Fighting is all they have ever known. What is truer of the black body than this? The founder of One More Book, a nonprofit organization that encourages reading among children in countries with low literacy rates, Wayétu Moore is the author of She Would Be King, a Book Expo 2018 bus selection, an ALA Book Club Central official selection, and a most anticipated book for 2018 by the Millions in the Rumpus. Her work has appeared in the Paris Review, Guernica, The Atlantic, and elsewhere. Her memoir, The Dragons, The Giant, The Women, is forthcoming from Grey Wolf Press. Please join me in welcoming her to the stage.
Hi. Yes. Thank you all for coming tonight. So my novel, thank you for that introduction, is quite wonderful. My novel, it explores the history of Liberia through three characters with supernatural ability. Liberia has a very complex history, but that complexity is really manifested through the groups that make up the Republic, and that is freed blacks and former slaves who immigrated to the region that they called Liberia in the early 19th century. Freed blacks and former slaves from the Caribbean, mostly Barbados actually, who immigrated to the region in the late 19th century up until the early 20th century, and then the indigenous groups, 15 or so that existed on the continent in that region at the time. So the three of them, they are making sense of a new republic as colonialism is still present on the rest of the continent, and of course slavery is still going on in the rest of the Western world, but they do have a pocket of freedom. I am going to read to you from the introduction of this book, the introduction of the heroine. Her name is Bessa. She is someone who is a close friend who I felt like I introduced to people about a year ago. So, there were no Vi girls like Bessa. The coastal village of La had only seen one woman as cursed, Oma Famata, who they say is sitting in the corner of the moon after her hammock flung her there on her 193rd birthday. But even Oma Famata's misfortune was nothing compared to that of Bessa, whose curse was not only her inability to die, but also the way death mocked her. La was hidden in the middle of forest when Vi people found it. There was evidence of earlier townsmen there, as ends of stoneware and crushed diamonds were found scattered on hilltops in the unexpected company of domestic cats. But when the Vi people arrived from war-ravaged Arabia to the Mandingo inland in the early 18th century, they found no inhabitants and decided to occupy the province with their spirits. Before Bessa was born, Omanyapu, old, bitter, widowed, was living only two houses down from Kati, Bessa's pregnant mother. Omanyapu had a pudgy orange cat whom she beat regularly to numb her loneliness. The village elders warned Omanyapu about what the spirits had told them about beating cats, but she disregarded them. She was powerless to her pride, and she hoped she would make the spirits angry enough to reunite her with her deceased love. When Keno, Charlie the fisherman's slave, knocked on Omanyapu's door to deliver her the fish that her nets had caught, the pudgy cat stared hoggishly at the tin bucket. He hid behind the fire pit as Omanyapu closed the door in Keno's face and inspected the bucket for any sign of pilfering. When the cat's head peeked around the pit, she grabbed a fish from the bucket and waved it at him. "You would not touch it," she yelled, shaking the fish. Scales, salt water, and blood flew, and the cat dodged Omanyapu's warning. That night, when Keno finished his chore of cleaning fish for Charlie's wife, he blew the light from the last lantern away. The whistle his compressed lips made married the pungent smell of fish and journeyed through the village circle to Omanyapu's house, awakening the cat. In the dark, his cold nose led a desperate search for Omanyapu's bucket of fish. Omanyapu's leg twitched, and she snored expletives into the night. Alarmed, the cat positioned himself to run in the event that she leaped from her sleep to beat him with the redwood handle of the porch broom. But she remained in abysmal slumber in the murky room. The cat proceeded toward Omanyapu's fish, disregarding the likely retribution on the following day when she would discover that her fish were gone. When he finally reached it, he lifted himself up to the rim of the bucket, careful not to scrape the edge with his nails. His eyes were large, his mouth ready, when a hard blow threw him across the room. "I told you, Eneso," Omanyapu asked, lighting her lantern. The cat tried picking himself up, only to meet another hard slap to his head. He stretched his claws and hissed at the old woman, but she struck his head once more, and the cat shrieked, this time waking a neighbor, whose inquiring voice and lantern moved slowly toward the village circle. "Oh no," Omanyapu said, "you ain't going nowhere." She dragged him out from behind the fire pit by his tail. In the village circle, neighbors gathered outside of Omanyapu's door, baffled at what had made the old woman so angry that she beat the poor cat in the middle of the night. "I would teach you, you would feel it," she said. The cat screeched, unable to escape the bitter widow. The neighbors' tongues became sour, their ears warm, disgusted at the old ma's audacity in offending the spirits. Charlie knocked on Oma Nyapu's door, but she ignored him and continued beating the cat. "But she would kill the thing," said Charlie's son Safwa, an already handsome 5-year-old boy with skin the color of a coconut shell and eyes that were always asking a serious question. Inside, the cat lay in the corner as Oma Nyapu's stout figure and broom became blurry. Tired of seeing her, he let his eyes close and his heart stop and his mouth open. A frozen Oma Nyapu stared down at his body. She had killed the last living thing whom she could call hers and was now absolutely alone. She walked to her door out of breath. When she opened it, her neighbors stood in the village circle holding lanterns that illuminated their overwrought faces. Charlie peeked into the house and noticed the dead cat lying against the wall. "Eya," he said, astonished at Oma Nyapu's fearlessness. Upon seeing the dead animal, children scattered, returning to their houses. "The spirit's coming for you," Safwa said, the only remaining child in the circle. "Yeah, bury it for me," Oma Nyapu said as Charlie looked inside of her house at the cat. He said nothing else to her and avoided looking her in the face. He called Kano to retrieve the cat, and Kano minced out of the village and into the woods while a curious Safwa followed to bury the departed animal. In the morning, Oma Nyapu's house fell down while she was still inside. She died immediately. When they dug up her remains from a pile of palm wood, straw, and debris, Oma Nyapu's fish were nowhere to be found. Opa Bundo, who woke up every morning to pray before the rooster crowed, who had slept through the night before and knew nothing of Oma Nyapu's wicked deed, said he saw the orange cat jump to the top of her house before it fell down. "But a cat dead," Charlie said, refuting Bundo's claim. When the elders heard of it, they pronounced the day cursed, convinced that spirits had possessed the dead cat into coming back, avenging itself, and stealing the bucket of fish to quench his desire. So because of the edict, on that day, the drums outside of Kati's window were amply pounded. Her husband was already fishing at the lake, and she lay moaning in pain on a rectangular pallet woven with large palm leaves and stuffed with straw. Kati would have her baby soon. So in recent weeks, her husband had risen before the rooster's song and spent his hours at Lake Piso in hopes of catching enough fish to eat and trade in the village market. Neither Kati's father, nor her father's father, nor her husband or husband's father were talented enough fishermen to afford their household any slaves, so Kati had inherited nothing. At the moment she opened her eyes and heard the beating of drums, Kati pushed her aching body upward from where she lay. She was a dark brown woman with a slender nose and arms whose breasts and hips had fully developed only in the later months of her pregnancy. She knew by the rhythm of the drums that either someone had died or someone had been cursed, both of which posed a gloomy birth for her unborn child. Kati's stomach bent in distress. The gray of morning crawled from the open window toward her sitting body and exposed thin streams of sweat that descended her brown face and arms. Kati rubbed and patted her stomach, pleading for her unborn child to tarry just a little longer in her womb. She extended her hand to the floor from the pallet to drag herself to the window, but the uneven weight of her body made her baby's fingers and toes flex inside of her. "No, no," Kati whispered to her extended belly. "Wait, small, small." She pressed her hand on the floor beside her bed and tried again, this time successfully dragging her body off the pallet and across the room to the window, where she rested her back against the wall. Kati grabbed the frame, hoisting her body until her eyes uncovered the Baroque drummers outside. Salt and dust stained their palms. The opas marched around the drummers as their necks sank into robed shoulders. Kati knew what it would mean to have a baby at that moment, and she crossed her legs. Frightened that she would be seen, Kati collapsed to the ground, her body simultaneously hot and cold, her thin lapa imbued with sweat. She rubbed her stomach in great panic as her eyes canvassed the room for a solution to her disaster. Her pursuit ended with the door closest to the bush garden that led to the entry of the woods. Before Kati could move, a liquid stream of blood and water toddled down her thighs, chased by a more abundant outpouring that left her lapa and the floor around her drenched. To keep from screaming, Kati clamped her bottom lip with her teeth until she could taste her own blood. She could not risk them hearing her, could not bear the delivery of a child on this day when she would then be forbidden from ever offering another to her village. So Kati finally resolved that she would crawl as far as she could into the woods behind her house. The baby kicked, ready to approach the dim light in the opening. "No, no," Kati said again, as the floor beneath her continued to dampen. Her legs quivered. She clutched her lapa and squeezed. It was no use. The child would come. Kati dragged herself toward the door leading out to the woods. She used both of her hands and pulled her quavering body sideways. The child pushed. She squeezed her legs until her thighs ached from the resistance. "Please, my child," Kati repeated. "Wait. Small, small." The drummers pummeled away outside. "Wait. Small, small." And Kati pushed open her wooden back door and crawled toward a huddle of shrubs. She panted, drained, as she tried to stop the baby, first with an intermittent tapping of her stomach. Then she reached one hand underneath her lapa to impede the liquid from where her child pushed its way out. When only several yards away from her house at the end of a train of blood, with no power to ignore the pain that pushed underneath her wet and sticky fingers, Kati fell onto her back against the waiting leaves, unable to squeeze her slippery thighs together any longer. "Wait, small, small," unable to constrain the woeful head of her baby, Kati howled into the wind and sun. The drumbeat ceased. That was the day that Bessa was born. The elders declared that she was cursed. Thank you. That's all I got. Oh, were we going to do questions?
You know what? Since we have a little time, let's take a few questions. If you'd like to ask a question, you can line up on this side over here. Or you can raise your hand and I can bring you the mic.
Were any of your characters based on real people in your life and people that you've heard about? And if so, was it easier or harder writing based on actual people?
Yeah, I had a really great conversation earlier with some MFA students, and I revealed that the characters were, well, two, there were two instances. One, there's a character who's named after a third great grandfather of mine. His name was June Moore. And he was one of those who emigrated to Liberia from South Carolina, a town called Rock Hill, in 1871. And so I named June Day after him, just as a resistance to everything that he and his community experienced during that time. Can you hear me? And then the story that I just read to you, it is from a folktale that I was told by my grandmother. And she said, "Be kind to cats," because there was an old woman who beat her cat to death. The cat's ghost jumped to the top of her roof and killed her. And so I fleshed out that story, and then of course added Bessa's birth to that, and that was the inspiration for this book. I think it definitely wasn't difficult. If anything, it motivated me. Those stories and those particular influences motivated me.
For one more question, if anybody would like to ask. Otherwise, we can head upstairs for the book signing. Last call? All right.
First of all, thank you for reading to us. I really appreciate that.
Thank you.
I'm very curious about writing in terms of setting. Did you, when you were writing most of this book, were you writing it while you were in Liberia, in terms of were you in the place where you are writing about as you did the writing?
Mm-hmm. No, actually, the first draft of this was, I wrote the first draft of this before I had returned to Liberia after leaving when I was 5 years old. So it was during the editing round that I really relied on place and immersing myself in the environments that I was writing about. Everything else was experiential, from things that I had experienced before and from research. I relied very heavily on research.
All right, so we are going to head upstairs for a book signing with Wayétu. If you are new to Zell Writers Series programs and are not from the Zell Writers program, We would appreciate if you could fill out a quick survey on your way out just about how you learned about the event. There's also a sign-up sheet to be added to the mailing list of the African Studies Center. So if you want to hear news about Africa-related upcoming events, that's a great list to be on. Thank you all so much for coming.
Yeah, thank you for coming.